So Terrence, what was life like for you growing up in Clarksdale, Mississippi?
Well, life for me in Clarksdale growing up was pretty smooth. My mom, Earlene Metcalf, a hardworking woman. She raised five kids. But Clarksdale wasn't my start. I was 13 years old when I first moved there. My first part of my life, I was raised in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And we moved to Clarksdale after my grandfather passed away. My mom wanted to move and help my grandmother. And so moving there, man, it was a pretty smooth transition for me simply because there wasn't many distractions. And, you know, don't get to tell this story a lot, but, you know, there's a lot of different distractions in a city opposed to the country. And moving to Clarksdale, I had a cousin by the name of Jeffrey Williams that played football, and he asked me to come out. And so I went out with him. Had never played football before, so in seventh grade, I got cut. And, you know, I thought I was cut, but one of my coaches told me, you know, we don't cut guys, so come back out. You know, guys ridiculed me because I was just a big old, strong, fast person, but I never played the sport before. And that just was a thing that they weren't used to in Mississippi. Like, you big, you should be able to play football. And that wasn't the case for me in the seventh grade. But I had coaches like Aaron Holden, Curtis Kemp, and Coach Mullen, those guys that were at Higgins Junior High. They were pivotal in my life and the growth and development of me in football. And so those guys taught me how to be physical, how to have the right frame of mind. Just because somebody talked to you a certain way on the field, you don't just retaliate. Here's what we do. You know, we whoop them between the whistle. And so I learned that, man, and going into the ninth grade. So middle school for me in Mississippi was seventh, eighth, and ninth grade. And so you're talking about a seventh grader coming in. I'm just turning 13. I didn't turn 13 until that January of my seventh grade year. But I'm facing guys that are ninth grade who was already 16. Some of them may have been 17. And so you learn how to be tough mentally, physically, and then getting strong. Those guys taught me how to really respect and appreciate the weight room. So when I hit the ninth grade, I was benching 315. I was squatting over 400 pounds. And I could run. And I really made my mark on the defensive line. So that's when I started getting my offers from schools like Miami, Michigan, Ole Miss, schools like this, they offered me. And, you know, to be offered back then, you had no internet. So it was VHS tapes and your coach had to cut that up. So I knew nothing about that. But kudos to them because they found me. I was one of the many guys that they found out of Mississippi Delta. But then transitioning into high school, I left middle school with the right mindset. And so when I hit high school, man, I just worked hard. I believe in my relationship with the Lord. I treated everybody right. No person was bigger than the next person in my eyes. So if you were considered like the smart kid, I'm hanging with you as well as anybody else. And I just worked hard, man. And, you know, that transition just really helped me from middle school to high school to college. Had no idea about a college scholarship until I had a teammate by the name of Michael Vaughn who got an offer to Alabama. And I'm like, oh, I can get a scholarship? So I'm like, I'm going to school for free. And that was the catalyst in my life. And I was eighth grade then when I realized that, because Michael Vaughn was ninth grade at the time. I'm sorry, 10th grade at the time. And so that changed my everything. Come to Ole Miss. Had no desire about the NFL, but after my freshman year, I'm like, oh, I can go to the NFL. And I got hungry for that and I went after it. And so that was pretty much my transition from Milwaukee to Clarksdale. It was pretty smooth.
So when was that moment when you realized, hey, I have a chance to be a professional football player. I could make this a reality.
Well, I came here at Ole Miss, expecting to play D-line, but they moved me to the offensive line because we needed that position to be strong going into that season. And I finished as a freshman All-American and freshman All-SEC. and they were having pro day. We had guys like Nate Wayne, Devon Coburn, who was on our team, who were NFL prospects. Excuse me. And so I'm walking through the hall getting ready to go to the weight room, and one of the scouts saw me, and they was like, "Oh, you running for us today, big man?" And I'm like, "No, sir, I'm just a freshman." He was like, "No way you're a freshman." And that right there, man, changed my whole concept. I was already locked in as a player to just dominate just because I wanted to make my coaches proud, you know, make my mom proud. I'm representing my city.
And you alluded to it. It's like playing for your hometown school in a sense. But what ultimately led you towards choosing Ole Miss? And then what was just that overall experience like there? How would you, you know, categorize that?
Well, you know, like I said, I grew up in Milwaukee, so I had no loyalty to like Ole Miss or Mississippi State or Alabama. I was actually committed to Alabama at the time that I signed with Ole Miss. But when I, the thing that was the turning point was the coaching staff. Tommy Tuberville's coaching staff here at the time, three guys really, Joe Panunzio, he was the tight end coach at the time here, did a really good job. Noah Mazzoni was our offensive coordinator, and Hugh Knowles, who I continue to have a relationship with now. Those were the coaches that was recruiting me, and man, they just made it to where they were just so confident in themselves as a staff and what they could do for me in my career. When Hugh Knowles told me, "Listen, go take all the recruiting visits you want. I'll never try to steal that from you. There's places you've never gone. So go visit those places. But at the end of the day, I'm going to be your coach." And he stood on that. And then there was another guy here at Ole Miss by the name of Langston Rogers. He was the head of media relations. And Langston was just simply put it like this: if you come to school here and you do what you're supposed to do in the classroom, you work your butt off in the football field, and if you start as a freshman, I'm going to make sure that everybody know about you, you know, and everybody eyes are on you. And I'm going to be honest, man, like I had no other desire but to do my job. You know, I was the kind of player who I didn't like to let down my coaches. I didn't like to let down my teammates. And so that was simply put, "Oh, you're going to take care of me there. I got an O-line coach that's going to take care of me. I got a offensive coordinator that he knew how to utilize." Well, like I said, I thought I was going to be a D tackle, but converting me to O-line, they utilized me in a way to where I could pull, hit people as a freshman. And then the last 2 years, they moved me to left tackle. And, you know, with Eli Manning as the quarterback, it was kind of a move that they wanted to make and needed to make. And so I finished it up in 2 years, having given up one sack, you know, so I felt like, you know, they made the right decision and everything went well and ran smooth. And so that's what made me, and my teammates, Deuce McAllister, we were on our recruiting visit to old Alabama, Romero Miller, all three of us just so happened to be from Mississippi on a recruiting visit to Alabama at the same time. And we all decided at that time that we were going to go to the same school. So on top of the coaches, and then now we got a recruiting class that could possibly play together and change the whole outlook of what Ole Miss recruiting was. Because guys, the top guys wasn't staying in state and going to Ole Miss. LSU was in, Alabama was in, Tennessee was in. And that year, the class of 97, the majority of the top 10 guys either went to Ole Miss or Mississippi State. And when Romero committed, Deuce McAllister committed, they called me and they were like, "Hey, we said we were going to go to the same school." I was still committed to Alabama, but that morning in that library at Clarksdale High School, there was about 250 Ole Miss fans. And they made it difficult. And so I chose Ole Miss, and that was it.
This year marks the 20th anniversary of that 2002 NFL draft, which you were a part of. So what do you remember about that draft process and your experience?
So one of the main things, man, you're inviting family members over, you're trying to tell them and prepare their mind. I don't know where I'm getting drafted. you know, I just want an opportunity, you know, when it presents itself. You got your agent telling you you can be drafted from the first to third round, but I know you're going to go on the first day. And so my mindset was, okay, family here, Terrence Metcalf is going to set up him a place if it get too stressful to go. And I set up my back bedroom for myself where I can watch television, watch the draft, and the family can be up front and enjoy themselves. And so, man, one of the biggest fears is the unknown. And where are you going to go? Will you get the same kind of opportunity in the NFL as you were given in college? You know, because you hear all these rumors. It's called not for long. It's political, this and that. But I'm a firm believer, if you go and work and do your job and present yourself as an employee and you buy in, that things will work in your favor, you know. And so that day of the draft, man, it was just the uncertainty. But when I got that call from Chicago, man, I was just elated because I grew up in that area. I started out in Chicago, moved to Milwaukee, come back to Mississippi, and now, you know, the Lord has opened the door for me to go back to the Midwest and do the thing that I love. It was just a huge relief once they finally called my name. You know, I got calls in the first round, got called in the second round, but nobody pulled the trigger. And then Jerry Angelo, Dick Geron, those guys called me, and you know, they were like, "Do you want to be a Chicago Bear?" And I'm like, "Yes, sir, 100%." And man, it's just a sigh of relief because now I know I got a place to go.
So with that in mind too, what was your welcome to the league moment?
Oh, Chicago. Here's my welcome to the league. When somebody tell you the more you know, the longer you stay, I'm coming off my consensus All-American year. Now this year, I gave up no sacks. I'm the man, got the award for the number one O-lineman in the SEC, four different All-Americans. Well, and they said left tackle. When I got to the Chicago Bears, my very first practice, they said, "Can you snap the football?" And I said, "Yeah," but I'd never snapped the football a day in my life. And from that moment, I learned this: no matter what you did in college back then, there was no respect of that, you know, because to take an All-American tackle and throw him a football and put him at center. And at the time now, we got some stud at nose tackle. Ted Washington is at nose tackle. Keith Traylor is at nose tackle. I know these names are older guys, but these were some men. And my come to Jesus moment was when I had to line up against Ted Washington, who was 6'6", 365 pounds. And, you know, I got a great mentor in Olin Krutz, who had been the center for years. When I got in, he had been in for 4 years. And so he and Ted has a relationship. And Ted looks at me and said, "Hey, don't put your hands on me." And I'm looking at Olin like, "How am I supposed to block him if I don't put my hands on him?" He's that big cat. "I don't know what you're going to do." And so, but I came off the ball. I'm a football player. I'm a man first too, you know? And so, you know, after that, that was just his way of testing me and seeing how I would respond. But that was it, man. Like, I really had a really good group of veterans who, they were really no-nonsense guys when it came to how we were going to handle practice. The O-line was really tight. Big Cat Williams was the oldest guy, down to Olin Krutz, Chris Valerio, Rex Tucker, myself, Mark Colombo. And so we had a really good rapport, and we had each other back, man. And, you know, even though Ted said that, I'm like, I'm coming off the rock anyways. And he respected it. And after that, man, I was just like, man, I ain't no telling where I'm going to land here in Chicago, you know, what position I'll play, but I'm going to play my role, do my job. And, you know, it was fulfilling, bro. I can't lie. I had no You know, everybody wants to start and start immediately and be the guy. But with the unit I was on, man, I just was like, okay, I'm going to play my role and do my job, you know.
With that said, do you have a game memory or moment against the opposition, against an opponent where you remember going toe-to-toe in a battle thinking like, man, this is somebody I grew up watching, or is a really unique matchup and experience for you to be a part of on an opponent POV?
Be honest with you, man. It would be Warren Sapp in 02. We played them in preseason. So you get it early. Two games. You got Warren Sapp, and I'm just like, man, this is Warren Sapp, you know. And I'm looking at him, and he's like, if you want an autograph, just ask me for it. You know, and so I'm like, in my mind, I'm like, man, I'm a man too, so I don't need your autograph. But man, it was such a different moment when you get to see those big time players like that. Not just him, but there was a guy by the name of Tim Bowles. They called him 747 around here in Mississippi because he played here at Ole Miss after he played at junior college, and all I would hear about was Tim Bowen, Tim Bowen, Tim Bowen. And again, it was a preseason game. I got a chance to face him, you know, and that man is a special kind of nose tackle. He was a different individual, strong, fast. But man, it was like, it was cool to finally meet a guy like that. And you know, as my career continued to progress, you got, you know, Chris Hovan. And in his younger days up in Minnesota, it was an animal, you know, but just being in that room, like I said, with Olin Cruz, Chris Valerio, Rex Tucker, we game plan. So I learned how to be mentally focused and be able to block. It don't matter who it is. We going to game plan these guys. Chicago, you know, playing Detroit, Sean Rogers. Minnesota, you got Kevin Williams and Pat Williams. You know, and so you going in Green Bay, you got Jennings, Greg Jennings. So every game in your division during that time, there's no downtime. You know, even Marcus Bell as a backup in Detroit was an amazing football player, man, and just a tough guy. So and all those guys that I named, Kevin Pritchard, yeah, he was in his last days, amazing. You know, and then you get a chance to face a guy like Leroy Glover. You face John Randall just before he retired. Then my last game was Bruce Smith's last game up in Kansas City. And we played Kansas City, and I got a chance to play against Bruce Smith, man. That was an amazing, amazing time, man. That was a grown man. All those last guys were grown men. Even in their last days in the league, they were still committed to their greatness, you know. And so that, again, you meet guys like that, they drive you, you know.
What you mentioned this too with some of the different rule changes. How have you seen that the NFL has changed since you've retired, in your opinion?
One of the main things they've done, man, it seems to be a league that the players are the top priority now, the concern on that. And when guys are injured, they actually, it's okay to miss practice and not worry about your job, because the number one rule back when I was playing was you can't make the club in the tub, you know? So any ailment you had, if you can get it rectified prior to the team knowing. Most guys tried to do that without the team knowing if you got a concussion or if you may have broke your finger. If you can get by with a finger that's not completely severed, you would a hamstring pull or lower back tweaking, you know, those type of things. Guys were not reporting that, man. I just see like there's more care placed on the players that's on the field now. And a lot of people may contribute it to the money. I don't care what caused it, the money going up on the vets, whatever, but you can definitely tell there's a comfortability. And I get to see it now, you know. And I don't want to jump and talk about, you know, DeKalen, but I get to see it every year now, and I know the care that coaches have, the teams have for the players, you know. And for DeKalen, my son, I'm just, you know, I'm just grateful, and just I can look at it and I can see if, okay, if you're injured, you don't have the same stress that I had when I was injured. Do I tell somebody? Do I go see my specialist outside of the facility, you know, and get things rectified that way? But now they can just say, hey, need a few days off from practice. They get those few days, and they actually get an opportunity to step back in those roles and be the leader that they are on the field, be the player that they're on the field. So kudos to the league for whatever changes that they made from a doctoral with the doctors and, you know, with the team understanding that we're liable now for these guys. You know, that concussion lawsuit and that type of stuff, that opens some eyes, you know, and it removes some curtains that need to be removed so that the guys can be comfortable and go do their job without having to worry about if I get injured, which we both know with the game of football, that's inevitable. And it's going to happen to every player at some point in their career. You know, but to have that you can't make the club in the tub mentality and know that you're going to get injured at some point, man, that's so much stress. And now I see guys that are like, man, I got a concussion, but I'm good. I'll just go through the protocol, go back to work. You know, if I strain my hamstring, I'll go through the protocol, the treatment, and go back to work. And it's not the same. So that's why I see a total change in the mindset of organization, or at least the one I'm connected with now, the Seattle Seahawks. I see their how they treat their players and how things are going over there.
And it's so neat because, especially from like a mental health standpoint, I'm sure, like correct. You mentioned, where back in those moments in the days that you were playing in, you almost, I don't want to say afraid to speak up and share that you had those injuries, right? But you were, like you mentioned, like you're trying to play, make a living. So you're not, if you're out, unfortunately, there's, you know, all these different nuances and whatnot. So by now it's like, hey, it's okay to say, hey, I am in pain. Hey, this is how I am feeling, and not exactly. feeling like you're going to get any blowback or pushback for that is big, because that's, I mean, like those Tuesday player off days or those Mondays after a game, like, how early in your playing career did you have DK, and how did that shape your playing experience?
So we had me and my wife, her name was Tanya Malone at the time, but we had DeKalen going into our the fall of our freshman year. And so, you know, never, like I said, we had the right support. And I come from a big family. She come from a big family. And so it wasn't a scary thing, you know, for us. After my freshman year, though, you know, moving into my sophomore year, coming off a great year, All-American, All-SEC, and boom, Vanderbilt game, first 30 seconds of the game, blocking somebody, teammate goes the wrong way, falls on my leg, breaks my ankle. And so I had a lot of downtime at the time to spend with, you know, Tanya and DeKalen at the house, and couldn't travel with the team. And so it was so refreshing to have that, because like you alluded last time, mental health is so important to be able to pick up the pieces and move on. And my family, like I said, has always been my strength. Even as a player in middle school, high school, I did well because I knew that they enjoyed seeing me. And so to have my own, it was just even the more important, even after I broke my ankle, that they were there, because it gave me something to push toward. It gave me, you know, just somebody that I can make proud and see me overcome. You know, even though you're a baby, you don't really understand what's going on. You see me with crutches and things like that. And, you know, and so, man, actually, it made me and Tanya relationship so much closer, because we got engaged our sophomore year and got married right before the camp, before I got healed up and everything. We ended up getting married in July. So I've been married since I was a sophomore in college. So, being the middle child, being responsible, all that stuff started to factor back in my life and why I was a homebody, why I didn't go anywhere. Well, bam, I'm in college with all these responsibilities, on top of that with the family, on top of that with millions of distractions. And so, man, I wanted to make them proud and be what I could be for them. So it wasn't really a hard thing for me, because it was just to do the right thing was to be there and do what I was supposed to do for my family.
For you personally, though, too, when you reflect back, finding that balance between understanding that, yes, you have a great deal of responsibility on the football field, but you have this even greater purpose off of the field by being a father, being a husband. So how did you keep that in perspective, even when you were going through some of those difficult times dealing with injuries or some of those other instances that could have an impact on your mental health?
Well, again, when you got a really good coaching staff and you got the training staff and the support that you have in the SEC, it wasn't really a difficult time for me, man, because I always knew what I wanted. Like I said, I didn't know anything about the NFL, but after my freshman year, that was all that was on my mind. I'm like, okay, now I can support this family, you know, and then bam, an injury happens. But I knew that I wanted to be an All-American as a sophomore. I wanted to be first team All-American, not a freshman All-American. My goal going into that year, me and my tackle next to me, Tutan Reyes, we like, oh, we're going to be the best left side in the SEC, you know. And now we're facing, win SEC West. So we got Alabama, we got LSU, you know, Arkansas back then was a really tough opponent defensively. Vanderbilt had a wonderful defense as well. But we had determined in our mind that for greatness. And so it just so happened the time that I broke my ankle, unfortunately, Derek Burgess, who was a friend of mine here at Ole Miss, played defensive end, played 10 years in the NFL, led the NFL in sacks when he played with the Raiders. We both got injured at the same time. You know, Derek, at the time, he was in a serious relationship. And, man, we just bonded really well. And we got after it in the weight room. We couldn't do anything lower body. But at the time when I got injured, when I broke my ankle, I may have been bench pressing 450-some pounds. Well, when I came out of that, I was bench pressing 500 pounds. So you're talking about going into your redshirt sophomore year, one of the strongest guys, you know, and I didn't care about that, but I just knew that, you know, if I get my hands on you going down, and I knew that I would have an opportunity to be one of the elite guys in this league again. And so after that, man, just having Derek Burgess there, having my coaching staff who believed in me to get ready for the season. Oh, I was just bought into my belief that I can overcome anything, you know, and I really didn't try to put much pressure on Tanya, you know. DeKalen at the time had just turned 2 years old, so he really didn't understand anything but playing with crutches and, you know, leaning on daddy and, you know, being at the games had gone away because they weren't going to the games because I wasn't traveling. But coming into that next year, man, that was the same time that I got injured in 98 was the exact same time that Coach Tuberville and that staff left here and went to Auburn. But there was a wonderful staff that came in behind them. David Cutcliffe and my O-line coach, John Latina, they just picked up the same mentality, man, and they embraced my family. They embraced who I was as a player, made me a captain. And, man, it was just folks. Like I said, I wasn't going to the clubs. I wasn't a part of the fraternity scene in college. I wasn't, you know, I was just, they called me lame most of the time, but I was just a homebody who, you know, loved my teammates and loved my family, man.
What would be, like, your pointer or your biggest piece of advice to young football players, whether in college or the NFL, who are young, who are balancing fatherhood while also playing the game?
Well, one of the main things I continue to talk to people about is having a spiritual relationship. You know, I keep it separate. I don't know what people believe, but I know I believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So I have that connection with my Lord and Savior, man. And I believe you treat people how you want to be treated. And then at the end of the day, you work hard. You know, everybody's going to have their own little vices and things like that. But family is important. A father is supposed to teach a son. And when the Bible talks about teaching the son, it doesn't mean just a male. It's your children. You teach them. And so absenteeism has to go away. You have to be there regardless if you're not with that child's mother. And so in my mind, I'm like, man, if I start a family, I want this family. And that's what we had in that locker room with the Bears, man. It was so many guys. I was a young guy coming in there with a family where there were older guys who didn't even have a family. And so they embraced that. They embraced me as a young dad, and they admired that and admired the person that I was. And so I'm just like, okay, that's all. You have the right focus. You work your tail off and you show your family that you're committed to them.
When did you notice DK started taking a liking to the game of football, and what training regimen were you able to put him on that really got a chance to test his skills early on and see if this was something he can, you know, seriously pursue?
When the Bears used to send me home, they would send me home with a workout folder. And when DeKalen was in the fifth grade, we were here in Mississippi, and I was training at Ole Miss in the game field. And so I just started him running 110s, running what they call flying 40. So you sprint 40 yards, walk 10, come back to the 40, sprint back to the goal line. Man, I really did exactly what we had in our NFL training regimen. That's exactly what DeKalen started doing in the fifth grade, started doing in the sixth grade, except for we added in like running the stadiums, running 110s and all that. And everything went in the exact same day. And I will be honest with you, seventh grade, I could not beat him running anymore in seventh grade. The lifting, that didn't happen until probably a year ago, to where when I saw him benching 455 pounds for five reps, I'm like, okay, that's special. You know, even in the weight room. But in the seventh grade, when I could not beat him running, when I could not break him and make him fail, I'm like, I told him, I said, you could be something special if you continue to work like this. He had the mindset of caring for people already. And so I just shared with him that day at the field, man, three things, and he'll echo this till today. If you trust God, you treat people right, and you work hard, anything is possible at the end of the day. I can't guarantee you greatness, but you're going to be successful in my mind if you do those things. You know, you reach for what you want, and you work hard at it, and you treat people right on the way there, and trust and believe that the things you ask for, that you'll receive it. Amen. And then he bought into it, you know, but every kid, you know, they're gonna try to, like, when it get too hot, they're gonna try to figure a way out of it. And, you know, he did have the one day where he, you know, pretended like, you know, he was having this, some type of asthma attack. But, you know, I stopped what we were doing. I said, slow your breathing down, get some water, take a rest. And then we finished what we were doing. And, man, he really bought into the mindset of working hard, treating people right, and trusting God.
And I think it's neat because it was, in a way, the blueprint. You were able to provide a little bit of insight because he's fortunate to have, you know, a father with that background, mm-hmm. playing football at the highest level that can really show, hey, this is what it takes, especially at an early age, to instill some of that work ethic and those traits that you're going to need down the road. But what's also nice about it is there was no shortcuts. like you mentioned too. It wasn't like anything was handed. It was like, hey, here's what I'm going through, and you know, tips and drills that I can share with you that could prepare you for what you might face at that highest level, but you got to put the work in. So was that part, right? On that same note too, you mentioned this about lifting earlier, and we know, you know, DK does this thing in the weight room too, and is very fit. What were you feeding him early on in his childhood to, you know, to prepare him to bulk up in that way?
One thing I know my college teammates used to call him a little muscle. He was already built that way, man. And I tell people I started lifting weights. I may have been too early, but he started lifting weights when he was 5 years old, man. And it just, man, kid never complained. Anything I asked him to do, he would do it, you know. And I had a strength coach that told me to stop him from lifting free weights. But he always loved grabbing the dumbbells, curling dumbbells, grabbing the straight bar, trying to curl a straight bar. His whole life. And when we started working out, like I said, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, I mean, it was, you can tell the strength was there. He wasn't a powerlifting guy because he played football, then went to basketball, from basketball straight to track, tried to be a pinch hitter for the baseball team. And I'm just like, no, we need to slow things down. But if he could have did powerlifting, he would have did powerlifting. I think he would have did extremely well in that. But just, I've always seen that drive in him because he was competitive. But the weight room stuff, it was just really good strength coach at the high school level as well. Jason Russell, who had played at Central Arkansas, played for the Giants, and it just so happened our staff was just a crazy staff here at Oxford High School at the time. And so Jason had gotten his strength and conditioning certification, and he put together just like an amazing workout program for those guys. And, you know, that's how I saw DeKalen just elevate, man. He was already, there's a video out where he was at Ole Miss, he power cleaned like 355, but he was already like in the ninth grade power cleaning 275 already, you know. And so it was just like, okay, now the world know, but we already knew he was squatting 550 at Oxford High School, so we already knew that the strength was there. But that freshman year when he went to Ole Miss, and I just saw him just completely transform, man. He went from like 6'2 to 6'4 and just really strong in the weight room.
And I was just looking this up while you were mentioning, just to clarify, because I remember, you know, coming across it and from one of the podcasts that he did where he talked about eating the candy and drinking a coffee and having the one meal a day. And I was like, man, I was like, I'm pretty sure there's a lot more, at least to the lead up, you know, that got you to look that way for sure. But it's funny because it's like you were mentioning, here's the regimen early, but it's like that at that point now you can kind of find that balance between everything else. So, yeah.
Right now, I run into a lot of people that's like, he really eat 3 bags of candy, 1 meal, and a cup of coffee. I'm like, don't believe the hype, yeah, man. He really is like, DeKalen really buys into it. Mostly it's going to be vegetables all season long, maybe a little fish here and there, but it's going to be vegetables. And so when it comes to like game day, he's going to eat some candy on game day. But during the season, no, he's not eating 3 bags of candy. And he really is kind of like, you know, again, you got a guy like Russell Wilson, you got a guy like Bobby Wagner, Tyler Lockett, those guys in that locker room, they're like, and then he really looks at what LeBron James does with his body and the mental awareness that he have about that, especially during the season, it's crazy, man. And it was really refreshing for me to see that he was that mature being so young going in, not having a family going in, you know, and so you can easily be distracted. But, you know, having so many guys around him that know how to do it the right way, man, and then in an organization, they promote that, you know, doing it this way, doing it the Seahawks way. And that's been really, really good.
How did you And you even mentioned your own recruiting process, like setting, you know, film and tapes. It's a little different than when DK was coming up. So how did you guide him through that college recruiting process? And then what was that, just that, you know, influence and relationship like for the Ole Miss commitment ultimately?
So one of the main things for me with him was the training, but I knew that this could possibly happen if somebody comes in. So the first person that actually offered to Kalen was David Cutcliffe at Duke. And I had no idea that Kalen had a desire to play at Ole Miss. We had never discussed it. You know, I never said one word to him about, hey, you get offered, that's where you're going. I can remember a friend of his got offered and he started to ask me, you know, what was going on? Why ain't nobody offering? I'm like, if it's going to happen for you, it's going to happen for you. You know, at the time, I had a company here in Oxford called Game Time Rebels. And so what we did was we printed a print magazine here at Ole Miss. We cover recruiting. We also have the olemiss.247.com service. We, in our company, we work that service. And so I knew everything that was going on with the recruiting side of things for Ole Miss. And so he knew that I'm in tune with the recruiting stuff and what's going on. We never went to a bunch of camps because I didn't go to camps growing when I was coming out of high school. And so I'm like, why do you need camps? You know, at that time you didn't, but now I'm not going to say camps are not needed, but because I think with COVID happening, it kind of changed things. And so with the Kalen, I was just like, okay, you know, continue to work hard, continue to play hard. But I had, like I said, Joe Penunzio, who was my tight end coach here at Ole Miss, he ended up being director of operations at Alabama. And so I started taking the Kalen to that camp in the ninth grade. He went ninth grade, 10th grade, his 11th grade year. And man, I love the way they ran the camp. And I saw Nick Saban out there working with those guys. He worked with every DB, so I know he's going to get a chance to see DeKalen at wide receiver. And DeKalen really did well from every year, ninth grade. He improved every year, working with the wide receiver coaches over there, improved every year. And so and he started getting the offers, and I had no idea the day that he was going to commit to Ole Miss. He came over here, and they did a 7-on-7. And he really did well. And they offered him, and he committed. He committed the next day. And he never, ever wavered in that commitment. So I was just like, okay, well, you know, long as we're here, we live here, so you can't decommit. You can't play, I'm 90%, I'm 100%. We're not playing that game. So if you make a decision to go somewhere else, like I told him, I was committed to Alabama. When I signed with Ole Miss, I didn't play the games. I didn't talk the talk. Said, so don't get caught up in the recruiting rhetoric. And he just listened to me, man. He gave me the opportunity as he got older to continue to parent in his life and parent in his career. And it just started blowing up for him. He was one of the first guys to be rated like a 5-star. And I also explained to him about that. When I came out, I was the number one recruit out of the state of Mississippi. We had no stars. And so that doesn't matter. They demoted him down from a 5-star to a 4-star for whatever reason. Nothing ever changed. He continued to get the yardage, the touchdowns, going to his senior year. And so that right there in my wording, how I taught him, he saw it happen, you know. And so he trusted me and trusted what I told him about just the recruiting process, and that things would go the way he needed it to go, as long as he trusted God, worked hard, and treat people right. You treat people right, can't nobody say nothing negative when a recruiter comes to the school. You know, if you work hard, they can't say anything but positive things about you. And if you got a relationship with God, you're gonna do those things. Not all the time, but most of the time. You know, you're still a human being, and you still gonna make mistakes, but consciously you'll be aware of your actions, and that's toward people and it's toward your, in your surrounding. And so, man, it was just he really didn't get frustrated with anything. He took his visit that he wanted to take and made his decision and stuck with it and signed with Ole Miss.
And what was that moment where DK came to you and said, "Hey, Dad, I'm ready to take that next step now and play in the NFL." Do you recall that moment, what that scenario was like? And then that number one piece of advice you offered him that really hit it home to know, okay, he's got this. He's ready.
And then when, you know, coming back, he had a really good red shirt freshman year. Then the next year, he ended up this red shirt sophomore year breaking his neck. And so that was the turning point for me. I'm like, okay, if there's going to be an opportunity, you need to take it now. Because after this, they're going to say, "We can't touch this kid, he's injury prone." And so once we went to the doctor, this is during the neck injury deal, they said, "Oh, it's just a bone dislocation, no nerve damage, no anything like that." And I told him, I just told him myself, I said, "You're not going back to Ole Miss. You got to come out." And, you know, one of the toughest things was Matt Luke was a teammate of mine who was the head coach. And I knew he could utilize the Kalen in the offense going into that next year. But I'm thinking for my son's sake, for his future, we better move now, you know, act now. And I'm going to be honest with you. After that surgery, the doctor told the Kalen it would be 6 months before he was healed up. And this happened in October the 13th. By December, Decalen was all, the season was over with. He was already heading to Phoenix, Arizona to train. When we got there, they did their evaluation. He may have had like 3.8% body fat. They told him, "What we're gonna do, you're gonna lose weight and gain muscle." And when I went back in like 3 weeks, I'm looking at a totally different guy. You know, and this is prior to him going to the combine and all this stuff. Well, a photo surfaced of him training in XO, he and AJ Brown, and it just blew up. But man, it was just the neck injury. And my only advice to him was simply this: if you don't come out now, they're going to deem you injury prone, and you will never get to experience the opportunity, how you want the opportunity. And he never even second guessed that ain't going back. You know, again, one of those times where as a kid get older, you have to learn how to be a mentor and a voice of reason instead of telling them, "Oh, this is exactly what you're gonna do." You know, and so I was able to, he allowed me to be that once again in his life at a point where he could have said, "You know what, I'm gonna go back to college. I wanna be an All-American, I wanna do these things." But he didn't, he listened to us as parents and he entered the draft, man. And it was just, there was no doubt in my mind. I was keeping up with how he was transitioning at Exos. And then we all got to see everything come to fruition at the combine. And man, since then, he hadn't even second-guessed my opinion of things or, you know.
That's great. So, on, you know, that I didn't want to interrupt your train of thought on that note, Terrence, but we're on a follow-up too to that, the draft experience. And I know you mentioned earlier your draft experience and what that was like gathering up with the family and witnessing that as, you know, a player, but now seeing that from the shoes of being a father and seeing your son on draft day at that moment, what was that whole experience and moment like now with that coming full circle too?
Yeah, I was really excited to just that for him to be in the talks. Like, you know, early on after the combine, you look at a guy, big wide receiver that's 6'4", bench press 225, 28 times,
He jumped a 41-inch vertical. He ran a 4.33 in the 40. That's when all the talk started. You're going to be a first round or you're top five. I'm like, listen, I was told I'd be drafted in the first round. I was told I'd be drafted in the second round. I got drafted in the third round. So the name of the game is to get in. Let's get in, son. Let's get in, son. But, you know, with all the hype and attention to what had happened at the combine, only thing that Caleb wanted was the first round. I know I'm getting drafted in the first round. I know I'm going to get drafted in the first round. And so he got invited to the draft, and we went. And again, you got to sit there the entire first round. And, you know, we all men. I can say, you know, you don't have any pride or anything like that. But at the end of the day, I'm a man first. I'm emotional. And you sat there for 32 draft picks and your name doesn't get called, and you got to walk out of that green room and go back to the hotel and go home and sit and wait all day for the draft to start. And then in the second round, it just, you know, when you see all the emotion from him in those videos, man, just the weight after the neck injury and hearing a doctor tell you you would never play football again. And you hear another doctor say, you know, this is nothing. I've performed this surgery many of times. And you got your parents telling you just trust the process, trust God, don't worry about anything. And all these different emotions. And then the team call your name, man. I was just so relieved that the stress was off his shoulders just to hear his name called. You know, I knew the work ethic was going to always be there. And I know he had football smarts because he put the time into it to know the game. But, man, all that just kind of like culminated right there when the Seattle Seahawks called and asked him, was he ready to be drafted, man? And, you know, you hear him say, why'd you wait so long? You know, he had already talked to Pete and those guys, and you know, they said, if you're around at this pick, we're going to call you. But like I always reiterated to him, the name of the game is to get in. And if you get in, what are you going to do with the opportunity when it presents itself? Because a lot of guys get drafted. A lot of guys go to the NFL, but a lot of guys are not pros. And that was it, man. And I was just elated and full of emotions and just so excited for him. And because of the neck injury and because of how severe it could have been. And I get to see a blessing every day, you know, because a lot of guys that we had a kid in Greenville, Mississippi, who had suffered a C2 and a C1, and that kid passed away. DeKalen got an opportunity to talk to his family. There was a young man at Miami who fractured his neck as well, but he had nerve damage and he's no longer playing. Well, I got a son who did the exact same thing, and now he just got a phone call. And so, man, to God be the glory that, again, I get to see it every day, you know, and it is a reminder for him there's a purpose for you, and it's bigger than football, you know. But you get to go out and show people that regardless of what's been told to you and regardless of, you know, the circumstances, it's just your mental focus and how well you recover from things and how hard you work, man, and you can overcome things. And we talk about that, and he understands and he has it written down where he never forget, you know. Milwaukee Miracle, man. And the draft itself, to get your name called, but just to have your child every day when you know it could have been different, that's the blessing, man. You know, and that's why I get excited about just seeing it play. And even the times where I can cringe, I'm still excited because, you know, it didn't have to be. So.
What do you recall about that first game? What was that moment like? being a father in the stands, watching your son take the field in his first ever NFL game?
First game was all nerves, man. I don't know if he was as nervous as I was, because I'm like, okay, I know this guy told me the injury, but he'll hold up. But I was waiting on that first hit to see how he would do. You know, I ain't care about no yards or no catches. I just wanted to see how you gonna respond when you really get hit. And is it in the back of your mind about your neck? And man, from day one, after he showed me that, after the first hit, after the first catch and hit, I'm like, let's go, man. Let's go. And every Sunday, you still got those nerves, but still it's like, man, I get to see this dude compete. You know, he always knew how to use his hands like an old lineman, because I play O-line, and we talked about, you know, a wide receiver being like a defensive lineman and a cornerback being like an old lineman. The cornerback wanted to get his hands on you and keep you off the line. But, man, just DeKalen taking that, and in high school, he watched the blind side. So he was able to block a kid, and just like Michael Orr. And he came back to the sideline. He's like, Daddy, you saw me get that pancake. And so to see him get a pancake in high school, in college, and the pros, I'm like, I'm a proud old lineman dad, you know what I'm saying? So, that was one of the biggest part of his games, being able to block for guys when it wasn't his turn to catch the football. And so I think, you know, as a father, to sit there and watch that, man, you put it in words, it's a blessing every time you get to see it, you know, because the percentage is low for guys to get this opportunity. And for both of us to be able to do it is just amazing, because it's not that it's a hard thing to do. It's a hard commitment to make because it has to be a lifestyle, it has to be a life change. And it's been wonderful to see since day one, since he started to play, his commitment to being that guy, you know, and to get to this level.